Okay, well, good afternoon, everybody, and delighted to be here. The very first thing I'd like to say before I even introduce myself is that this is being filmed, so I hope you're all okay about that. It'll be on the website within 24 hours, I'm told. Second thing is my name is Annette Capel, for any of you who don't know who I am. I have a background in exams, in testing, but also in lexicography, and those are my main interests. And for many years I was a Cambridge writing examiner, and what we're going to be doing this afternoon is really focusing on B2 writing, as the title of the talk suggests. Can I just have a show of hands? How many of you are actually preparing for Cambridge English First at the moment? Okay. Yes, yes. Oh yeah, not taking the exam. Okay, and how many of you prepare for other Cambridge exams, prepare your students for other Cambridge exams? Okay, good. Right, and welcome to those of you who've just come in. This is the plan. As I say, it is a workshop and we're going to be working with a four-page handout this afternoon. So I thought we'd start with some very simple sentence-level examples of what constitutes B2 level. Now, obviously, it's just a snapshot, but I think it helps us to orientate to the level. So we'll look at that, and those examples have come from the Cambridge Learner Corpus. Any of you who were at the session that Geraldine Mark and Anne O'Keefe gave before lunch, that was also based, the material was based on the Cambridge Learner Corpus, but I will just explain that briefly. Then we're going to focus on the assessment scale. You have that on page one of your handout, and I imagine that many of you in this room have already engaged with it, perhaps in the Cambridge Handbook series, so you know what's going on there. But for those of you who don't, it's a continuous scale of assessment which is focusing on four different areas, and that's what we're going to look at this afternoon. So content, communicative achievement, organisation and language. And I think if you're preparing for any of these Cambridge exams in the general English suite, you know, we need to think in terms of those separate areas and what we can do to develop students' competence in each of those. So that's the main content for this afternoon. I will also touch on vocabulary because it's so dear to my heart. And finally, I did want to draw on some other examples from the English grammar profile because, again, I think it's very appropriate for anyone who's preparing students for B2 level writing, or indeed any levels. Okay, well, let's make a start. As I said, I've taken these four sentences, and for me, they represent elements of B2. So I'd like you to tell me, for example, this first sentence. Can you all read that at the back? Read the sentence and just suggest to me what constitutes, or what are the characteristics of B2 in that sentence? Anything at all that you notice? Sorry? Collocation, okay, good, yes, yeah, and would prefer. Yes, indeed, I have never done it. Anything else? It's a complex sentence, yes. Error-free as well. Anything else on the grammatical side that you notice in that sentence? Yes, that's really good, isn't it? And here we've got a passive infinitive and the negative there, not to be missed. Okay, so we've got a long and complex sentence, not containing any errors, and we've got these various things that we notice. Now, what about the next one?
Well, there's a mistake there.
Yes.
It's still quite an ambitious sentence.
Absolutely, Yeah, it's a third conditional, which apart from that knowned is correct, isn't it? So yes, that's good. So, not always error-free then, we've got to bear that in mind. And remember that examiners reward ambitions, so they will reward attempts, even if they go wrong, like this one. Okay, next one. Yeah, we've got a phrasal verb. We've actually got a three-part phrasal verb there, haven't we? Come down with. Yeah. Yes, correct. Yeah. Yeah. So again, we've got an error-free sentence. What about the tone? Anything you notice there? Yeah, we don't know who they're writing to, do we? So maybe that's a bit unfair. But yeah, I think generally it's a good attempt.
Natural, I think, my sister came down with.
Absolutely, yeah.
And students, I always say that.
Yeah. Last one. Longest. Now, what makes it so good then? What? Absolutely, yes. So we've got an attempt at organisation here, haven't we? A linking device or cohesive device, as far as something is concerned. Yes, yes. You've got that little bit extra there, haven't you? I must say it was disappointing. And again, it's long, it's complex. It's error-free. So all of those four sentences have come from different candidate scripts. They all passed Cambridge English First, or First Certificate, as it was known in the earlier ones. And yeah, so there are these general things. There's longer sentences. There's being ambitious, even if, you know, the attempt doesn't quite come off. Because what the examiner is looking for, certainly in terms of the language, is the range. Because, you know, the examiner is assessing what's there and wants to see good range of language. We'll come to language later on in the afternoon. I said I'd just talk very briefly about the Cambridge English corpus, of which the learner corpus is part. So you have this very big, fat tree trunk. We have something like 3 billion words of first language user data, written and spoken. And that branch off to the right, as you're looking at it, is the learner corpus. And that's where those examples have come from. And the learner corpus now constitutes 55 million words or more of learner data coming from all over the world and all levels of the CEFR. And not only general English exams, but the more specialist, academic, the IELTS scripts and so on. So we have a huge resource there to actually pick up on actual evidence. And that's what's fed into the various publications and research projects. Now, the fact that we can get different levels of performance, so if I want something that's average B2, I can find that, or a strong candidate who's near the top, as you pointed out with that last example, I can filter to get those. And we do also have error-coded data, so the mistakes, if we're searching on a particular mistake, we can find the data for that. But this afternoon, we're not focusing on errors. We're focusing on what students can do and encouraging them to do the best that they can. So we're going to have a think about what's important in each of these four assessment criteria. So we've got content, communicative achievement, organisation, and language. And for those of you who haven't seen the assessment scale before, as I said, it's on page one. Now, interestingly, this is part of a continuous scale. So you could be sitting a B1 exam below this level, B2, and band 1 here would be the band 3 of B1. And conversely, if we go up to C1, band 5 for B2, equivalent to 3 on a C1, exactly. So we have to think of this rolling assessment that goes through the levels, which is very important. And the other thing you'll notice is that there are no descriptors for 4 and for 2. For 4 and 2, we see bits of both. So we see some band 3 characteristics, some band 5 for a 4, for example. Now, I said we were going to think of all 4 assessment criteria. Let's start with content. Sorry, apologies for this slide, but you've got it on your handout as well. Content is basically, for this part one task that we're looking at this afternoon, content is defined by the task itself. And I'll show you an example of that in a minute. And what is very important is the relevance. So covering points, being relevant to the topic, and so on. And making sure that that target reader, whoever the reader is fully informed. Now, just to give you an example of a part one task for anyone who doesn't prepare for this level, since early 2015, this has been the essay task on FIRST, and students are given either a question or a statement. It's a compulsory task, so they're all answering this task, and they have to use the notes that they're given. In other words, they are given 2 content points, which they must include, but they're also given a gap. And this is where they have to come up with a 3rd relevant point. And so often, students seem to struggle with this, and struggle in class with it. And I don't know how you prepare for the writing, but it seems to me that we've got to give them preparation time for content in the classroom itself, because students, particularly younger students, seem to be short of ideas, and they are going to need to come up with this 3rd idea. What do you think about that? Do you think it's class time well spent in terms of brainstorming content, for example? Is there any other way we could do it? Is there any way in terms of, I don't know, out of class digital resources, is there a way that we could get students to share their ideas before they start writing? I think this is something we need to think about carefully, because otherwise they're going to get into that exam room, they'll deal with the 2 points that they're given, but they may struggle to come up with the 3rd one. Well, we're testing developing an essay, developing the argument for an essay. Mm-hmm. But part of that is to see their own language within that task, and that involves their own content, obviously.
I find that they sometimes can't do one of the points that have been
done. Oh, right. Yeah.
The 3rd one is easier for them.
Okay. Yeah. So again, how do you cope with that? Do you discuss it in class first?
I do it the opposite, but I mean, they're very good at finding their own ideas. They're used to essays, thinking of
open essays.
Ideas.
Yeah.
Now they're kind of willing to accept.
Right. Okay. Content. It's something I think we need to devote time to. So, I mean, whether it's preparing them for the topic generally. I mean, there are a finite number of topics that tend to come up in these tasks. Focusing on the relevance, that's obviously something you can feed back on in your marking, but actually getting them to come up with ideas. Now, let's move on to communicative achievement. And in a moment, we're going to look at an actual script from last year. Communicative achievement, I wanted to focus first on ideas No, it's linked a bit to content. We have this notion of straightforward or complex ideas. So if, for example, you look here at the 3 and the 5 on the page one, you will have communicate straightforward ideas for a 3 and communicate straightforward and complex ideas for a 5. And I think, again, we need to sort of get into this wording and have a think about complex ideas. So we'll do that through the script in a moment. Organisation, I mean, these are terms that come up in the handbook. So we're looking at cohesive devices, variety of cohesive devices, and this rather nebulous term, organisational patterns. And we'll focus again on that in a moment. And then finally, language. And maybe language is easier to define in terms of the B2 level. Okay, ideas. Straightforward and complex ideas. Trying to define what the difference is. I mean, this is not necessarily watertight, it's just some contrasts. So that for a straightforward idea, it tends to be narrower in focus, it tends to be concrete, and, you know, generally demands less sophisticated language. Whereas complex ideas cover a broader subject area and are more abstract. So if you turn over and look at page 2 on the handout, we have here an example of a part 1 essay from last year, as I said. The first thing I wanted to say before you even start reading this example, you'll see the word count is dead on 190 words. And I was given the hard copy of these scripts and, you know, made my choice, and this was the one that came up. But I wanted to tell you what happened with the script, because actually the candidate had written a little more than 190 words, but clearly felt that they might be penalised if they went over 190. So must have spent at least 5 minutes crossing out phrases and so on. What I wanted to impress on any of you who are preparing for a Cambridge exam is that the word limits are there for guidance, really. And it's really not worth wasting time in the exam room refining it down to the last word. Sure, students need to practice to develop their essays around 140 to 190 words, but, you know, examiners will not be counting those words themselves. They're looking for a good performance on an essay. So that was one thing I wanted to say to you. Now, what I'd like you to do is to read this answer. It's a part one task about elements of work. It's comparative then and now. And I'd like you to look specifically at the descriptors for communicative achievements. So I've given you the 3 and I've given you the 5. And for you, the important thing is the wording here. So be on the lookout for complex ideas, for whether it holds your attention, and whether it uses the conventions of the essay. In other words, look at the register, the tone. Is it personal, impersonal, and so on? We're not necessarily marking this today, but we're trying to get a feel for what a good first certificate part one looks like. So I'm going to give you 2 or 3 minutes to actually read that just for the communicative achievement, and then to share your ideas with the person next to you. Is that okay? If you don't have anyone next to you, you'll need to move. Okay. Just need one.
Yeah.
Back to you then.
Do you have to give us a question as well, or do you think it's not necessary?
I've not been allowed to give you the question. Okay. I don't think it's necessary, no.
So we just have to take their own target?
Yeah, we're not looking at content. We're looking at communicative achievement and, you know, whether there are elements of the five or the three for communicative achievement. You can take it as read that the 3 points were covered, if I can say that.
Yeah.
The descriptive, I mean, this is what we're using for what you're doing here. It doesn't sound like a problem that a lot of teachers have had since 2015 is the descriptors are all there, but they're not defined.
Or it's amplified.
No one has articulated what they actually are. So
right.
I'm assuming this, in terms of community problems, is the achievement is veering more towards 5 and 3.
Yeah.
And the problem is that we're saying that a lot of the teachers just focus on errors.
Yes.
And swathing.
Absolutely.
So I can't help wondering how that differs from what an examiner sees. How many hurdle statements do examiners get to see?
What do you mean by hurdle statements? They don't have anything else. They work with this, the same. But
exactly the same.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
But surely, because the descriptors seem so vague, one imagines there being a spectrum of definitions by each.
I guess it's through training that you show exemplars of what a 5 is, what a 3 is, and you know, in training and monitoring, because you know everyone is monitored, that you gradually reach a consensus.
That's the intriguing thing about this session, getting it defined.
Yeah, good. Okay, have you all had a chance to read the answer and to start talking about communicative achievement? What did you notice in terms of, let's start with the ideas themselves. Did you find any complex ideas? Do you think there's evidence of that? Yes. Yes, and the machines you mentioned?
Machines and the industry.
Yeah.
The
So these are broader subject, they're generalisations, aren't they? They're addressing a bigger area, if you like. So yes, I think there is good evidence of complex ideas within the task set. I mean, this is a short essay task on working life, how it is now, how it was 100 years ago or whatever. But I think there is evidence of that. What about the conventions of the task? So the actual, the register, the tone of the document. Any views on that? Was it appropriate? Oh, sorry, I should have explained that I underlined all the nows and nowadays. We'll come to those later. Sorry, I should have said that. Ah, but we're still on communicative achievement. Yeah. Organisation will come. Yeah. It's so hard to separate these four, but I think it's really worth doing to actually make sure we focus on each of them individually and, you know, give students enough training in each of them. Okay, so we feel the register is appropriate. Yeah. It's the tone is impersonal, isn't it? There's no I think or I believe. It seems to read quite well on that front. Yeah. Did it hold your attention as you read it?
No, not really. Oh. I read the third paragraph twice to really see what you're trying to say.
Okay.
Yeah. So
oh, you're so cynical. Okay. So communicative achievement, don't forget about it, and you know, maybe occasionally feeding back just on one of these criteria, you know, just focus on that in your marking. Don't talk about the errors, don't talk about the fact they've missed out a point, just, you know, remind them of what's going on here. It's so important for the essay, I think, to get that right. Right, next slide. Okay, well, organisation, we are going to think about that now. Now, what the descriptors say, we've got 5 and 3 at the bottom of page 2, and we're going to move on to page 3, organisation. We want a variety of linking words and cohesive devices for a 3, and we want a variety of these and organisational patterns for a 5. Let's start with cohesive devices. What's meant by that? Well, first of all, is a cohesive device. Firstly, secondly, thirdly, and so on. But these would be very basic. I mean, you see a lot of it in the first certificate scripts, but your students can do better, I'm sure. So rather than sticking to, you know, something which is basic, is A2 level according to our vocabulary profile, let's see what else we can use. And here's an example of a B2 one to begin with, used to give the first important reason for something. So we're thinking, when we're preparing organisational features, of variety and level, pitching it at the right level. And to begin with is a good example of that. Right, well, we're going to do a task.
Sorry.
Not finished with the script. Oh no, no, it it will come back. Yep, I had to remind myself then. Okay, let's have a look. Same script at what we can find listed on the top of page 3. This has come from the first handbook. The very useful glossary of terms, where there is a bit more meat, a bit more explanation in terms of what is meant by cohesive devices, organisational patterns. So I'd like you to just read those summaries and then go back into this essay again and see what evidence you can find for organisation. So text is well organised and coherent, using a variety of cohesive devices and organisational patterns for a 5, or for a 3, we've lost the organisational patterns It's well organised and coherent, using a variety of linking words and cohesive devices. So just find any examples you can in that script of the three categories we've got here: linking words, cohesive devices, and organisational patterns. So, have I got any offers? Linking, just simple linking words. What have we got there? Yes, well, we've got those. We've got the word so, initial position, haven't we, in the second paragraph. Okay. However, Yeah, now what's good about nevertheless? Because I think nevertheless, of all those that we've mentioned, is the one that's most B2 and is really impressing this examiner. So what's nevertheless doing in terms of organisation?
Contrasting it.
Yeah. So it's actually referring back, isn't it, to the previous paragraph, contrasting that, bringing in a new idea. So nevertheless, that's a very good example there of a cohesive device, I think. We've also got... So we've got the however in the previous paragraph, you mean?
Sentence, which the nevertheless follows.
Mm.
Given their relative synonymity, would that be
no.
That as a good thing?
No, I think it's perfectly appropriate, isn't it? I think, yeah. Yeah. Okay. There's one other thing I've just mentioned, the other thing in the third paragraph. So here's an attempt not to go firstly, secondly, but in that third paragraph to say the other thing that had changed a lot. And I think, again, that's kind of going up in terms of the level. The individual words are simple, but the effect of the other thing is more sophisticated. Okay, now for these organisational patterns, less explicit ways of achieving connection. And I guess actually, nevertheless, could fall into that category, couldn't it? Because it is beyond sentence level or paragraph level even.
The way he uses a pleasure for one and a torture for the others.
Yes. Yes, so that might actually be an example of parallelism. It's almost, isn't it? The other aspect to that, arranging sentences in climactic order. For me, particularly that third paragraph, the student was very successful in leading up to the usage of machines. So I think, you know, the way the argument was expressed in that third paragraph was pretty good, pretty successful. Talking of parallelism, I was intrigued about this, so I did what you always do, and I Googled, just to give some examples, because it is a sort of nebulous concept, I felt. Well, here's some that were on Google. They're not written by learners, obviously. So Julius Caesar, you know, using that alliteration. What you see is what you get, the Apple development person. And then a very nice proverb, wounds caused by knives will heal, wounds caused by words will not heal. So it is this mirroring effect, if you like, within a sentence. So then I started looking in the learner corpus and I found two at B level, B2 level, in this sort of set phrase, if you like, the more, or the faster, the sooner, and so on. So the more you read, the more knowledge you have. So that's an example of parallelism, and an examiner would be impressed by that. The faster you write, the faster you write back, the sooner we can make this trip. Okay, so those are, less erudite maybe, but perfectly acceptable B2 examples of parallelism. Okay, well, let's move on to language, and at last, those now and nowadays underlinings will become clear, because what I'd like you to do is to look back at the script and between you now to actually suggest different ways of saying nowadays or now, because there are quite a few examples of that term or those two terms. And it seems to me that the candidate could have shone a little bit more by trying to lessen the repetition and to ring the changes there. So let's see how many you can come up with in a couple of minutes. Just going through that. Yes, there are mistakes in it. Yes, there are. Yeah. Why are they serious? But does it impede your understanding? I mean, you understand what he's trying to, or she is trying to say. You think that's affected that? Yeah, well, that's the tipping point, I think. That's the tipping point.
It is,
where
and there are other elements in this, and this is very restricted to nowadays now, which appears so frequently. And it's terrible, but to me, I've been watching B2C in the text for years. Yeah, that's certainly the first time. I've been watching Applied Science. I would not be looking for that part of it.
I'll tell you what he got in there. Okay, any suggestions? How many can we get to? Other ways of saying now or nowadays? Just shout out. Okay. Today, yeah? In this day and age, yeah? In the modern world. Any more? In the 21st century, absolutely. Yeah? Currently? Yeah, so we've come up with enough to replace a lot of those examples of now. Do you think this would be a useful thing to do with students in terms of working on a script? it was interesting that it, I mean, it is a function of the question, because it, the question is comparative, it's talking about now and then. But I think, you know, if we can impress on students that the way they can show their range is in these simple terms sometimes. You've come up with more than I did, actually. The only one that you didn't talk about was in our time. I wondered about that. And then I put these days, but I think that's probably too informal. So I'm not sure about that one. Yeah, just about. Okay, well, that's something to think about. The verb think, incidentally, that comes up a lot in essays. And, you know, again, if we can have a variety of verbs, rather than just I think this, I think that, and so on. Okay. Now, we're going to spend the last 5 minutes looking at English profile. In case you're interested, by the way, I can't tell you for each criterion what the mark was, because we're only given a total mark, but it averaged 4, so it was 16 out of 20. So, you know, make up your minds about that. We've had somebody focusing on the errors here who would probably have brought the language down to a 3, I think, wouldn't you? But, you know, conversely, the content's probably a 5, so 16 out of 20, a good mark. Okay, so English vocabulary profile, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that because I've presented it at IATEFL before. Are any of you using it?
Yeah.
Few? You should all be using
it.
You can, indeed, yeah. You can search it in terms of its advanced criteria, advanced searches. The example I've got here is topics, but you can indeed, under category, just select phrases. So you can go word, phrases, phrasal verbs, or idioms. So you could just focus on the phrases, and that's how I found those B2 phrases. Another aspect is word families and affixation. And that's all part of language development at B2. I mean, clearly it comes into the word formation task, but I think for the writing paper as well, it's a way of showing a range of language. And a very nice feature on English vocabulary profile is these word family panels. And those, you know, if we were interactive, I could just click on any of those and go straight to the answer, to the entry for that word. So if you haven't yet looked at the profile, do have a look at the B2 level for yourselves and familiarise yourself with the word family panels in particular. But let's move on to the grammar coverage. Now, anyone who came to that talk this morning at 12:30 will have learned some of these, or heard about some of these findings. So I think what was being said is that by B2 level, so at the end of B1 level, let's say, there is already quite a lot of grammar that's been taught. It may not always come out accurately, but there is a solid foundation there. And, you know, in terms of the syllabus, there's relatively little to introduce. It's much more the case of refining, of broadening the repertoire for those grammatical points. Now, we've seen in those very first examples that there is growing confidence, and that allows for these longer sentences, mainly error-free. Clausal structure gets more complex, and so on. But, as was said this morning, there are some basic errors. The countability aspect was dealt with this morning. The fact that informations and homeworks carries on right up to the sea levels sometimes. These are called fossilized errors, things that you really feel you can't get rid of. What Anne and Geraldine were saying this morning is very much that we do need to refine, to extend, and they gave some very nice examples. And for those of you who haven't yet seen the English grammar profile, I did want to alert you to it. There's a summary on the final page of the handout, but we'll just have a look at a couple of screenshots in the 2 minutes that we've got left. So it's online, it's searchable, it's free, and you can search it in many different ways. What I've done here is to search on a keyword. We were talking about writing and communicative achievement, so I thought politeness would be a good word to search on. And you get some very interesting results in terms of the grammar. So in terms of subcategories of tenses, future perfect, future continuous, and so on. And then pronouns. So, you know, it's coming at grammar from a slightly different way, and I feel it's very useful for writing. Sticking with the politeness, we've got all the B2 examples on this slide, and we can see that the future continuous, used as a polite question form in place of the present simple or future simple. So these are small aspects of grammar that might actually, again, make the difference in terms of suggesting range of language. So this is what an entry would look like, this particular one on politeness. And again, we have these learner examples from our corpus. Something else that you can search on is what we call the super categories. There's 20 categories of grammar altogether. This one seemed very appropriate for writing, discourse markers. And I've set the levels, so I'm looking at B2 and then C1, just to see what's at the top of that scale, band 5 on B2. And again, some very interesting results, which are on your handout. And I think that's all I need to say on that. So general website address, englishprofile.org, that will get you into both of those resources, the vocabulary and the grammar. And for the Cambridge handbooks, that's the general address for those as well. But I did want to leave you with one further set of examples from the Cambridge Learner Corpus. These go back to when the compulsory task was a letter, and a letter on B1 as well. For example, we have kinder grades. We have many examples from preliminary B1 level of yours fried, which was nice. The next one is quite fun. One little extra word has made quite a difference. And then finally, there's one rogue example, which I always enjoy showing, which is this. So that's where I wanted to leave it, with very best witches and loaves. Thank you very much.